Luke 13, and we're going to begin reading at verse 22 through verse 30. This is a passage from one of the Gospels as we go back to our series, The Ministry of Jesus Christ, Luke 13, verse 22 through 30. If you don't have it, the scripture should be on the screen as we begin to read it. I'll read it from the New King James Version, and it reads as follows, chapter 13, verse 20. And again he said, "To what shall I liken the kingdom of God?" Verse 22. "And he went through the cities and villages, teaching and journeying toward Jerusalem. Then one said to him, 'Lord, are there few who are saved?' And he said to them, 'Strive to enter through the narrow gate, for many, I say to you, will seek to enter and will not be able. When once the master of the house has risen up and shut the door, and you begin to stand outside and knock at the door, saying, "Lord, Lord, open for us," and he will answer and say to you, "I do not know you, where you are from," then you will begin to say, "We ate and drank in your presence, and you taught in our streets." But he will say, "I tell you, I do not know you, where you are from. Depart from me, all you workers of iniquity." There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all of the prophets in the kingdom of God and yourselves thrust out. They will come from the east and the west, from the north and the south, and sit down in the kingdom of God. Last verse, verse 30. "And indeed, there are last who will be first, and there are first who will be last." Amen. Coming from verse 24, you may be seated. "Strive to enter through the narrow gate, for many, I say to you, will seek to enter and will not be able." I'm going to use for a thing just for a few minutes. You must come in at the door. You must come in at the door. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you once again for being in your presence. Thank you for your love, your joy, and your peace. Thank you for your children who are here today to worship you, to give your name the praise, to give your name the glory and honor. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for those who have come out to worship with you. And right now, Lord, if there's somebody here who does not know Jesus as their Savior, Lord, we ask that the Holy Spirit would touch them today. And Lord, after hearing the gospel, that, Lord, they could say, "What must I do to be saved?" In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. You must come in at the door. As we go back, because we just came out of Resurrection Sunday, dealing with Passion Week, we now go back into our regular series, which is the ministry of Jesus Christ. Now, the ministry of Jesus Christ, we know now it has lasted for 3.5 years. We are now in that third year, coming to an end as we continue to work through the final season of Jesus' ministry on earth. And we want you to understand that as we go through these 7 years of going through the gospel, we thank God that we were able to record everything. You don't miss anything. We actually covered Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in chronological order for you, so you'll know how to go through the gospel and that you would not have to miss anything. But today we are now in a passage of scripture where Jesus is 3 or 4 months away from going to the cross. This is not Passion Week, it's right before Passion Week, maybe 3 or 4 months away. And there's something I should tell you before we get into this passage of scripture that will help you and help you understand what it means to go in through the door. And that is this: man was created, or mankind was created without sin. That's one thing we need to understand about mankind. Mankind was created without sin. We lived in a paradise, a garden of paradise made for us to enjoy. Life was wonderful as we were part of the kingdom of God. So God is good enough and is gracious enough to be a king that made a perfect kingdom there where God ruled. And we lived in his kingdom. But God told Adam and Eve this. He said, listen, this kingdom, my kingdom that you can live in is for you as long as you don't disobey my rules. As long as you obey my commands. As long as you remember not to eat of the forbidden fruit. So as citizens of the kingdom of God, Adam and Eve lived in holy communion with God. They did what God wanted them to do until one day they thought that they were better than God. They thought that they could become their own God. They thought they could outrule God. So what they did was they disobeyed God. They did the exact thing that God told them not to do. And God said, listen, as long as you can obey me, you can stay in my kingdom. But they decided to disobey God. You know what happened when they did that? Because a lot of people, when they look at the world today, they look at the world all tore up. They look at the world all messed up. And I want to let you know that that happened after they disobeyed God. Before the world was in chaos, they lived in perfect harmony with God. You know what they did? What they did was, when they disobeyed God, they joined another kingdom. And they didn't create their own kingdom because they couldn't create anything that way. They joined another kingdom, and the kingdom that they joined was Satan's kingdom. Now, they didn't know that they were joining Satan's kingdom, or if they did, they would have never joined it. But Satan sneakily got them to join his kingdom by getting them to disobey God. Now, watch this. When they disobeyed God and joined Satan's kingdom, that means they can no longer have communion with God. That means they can no longer enjoy that relationship and the fellowship that they had with God. As a matter of fact, God had to put them out of the Garden of Eden so they could not enjoy it. And ever since then, ever since Adam and Eve fell, guess what? We've been living in a world that's turned upside down. We've been living in a world that has been ruled by Satan. And as a matter of fact, Adam and Eve joined Satan's kingdom. You and I were born into it. This is all we know. All we know is a messed up world. All we know is a world full of sin. We were born into this world that was told. We was born into a world where the animals are against a man and nature is against man. And it's hard to grow crops and it's hard to live with each other. We were born into this, but it wasn't like this from the beginning. Oh, they had a perfect relationship. They were outside of the kingdom of God, but now they live in the kingdom of Satan. But let me tell you how good God is. God is so good that he said, you know what? I'm going to send my son,
yes,
Jesus Christ, to offer them a way back to the kingdom they used to be in. You see, we don't know what that kingdom looks like because, like I said, we was born in this kingdom. But God is actually allowing us through his son to come back into his kingdom. Not only that, God sent Jesus Christ to give us this message. I got the way back to the kingdom of God. Jesus came to tell you that he wants you back into the kingdom of God. But guess what you got to do? You got to do what the first Adam and Eve refused to do. You got to obey God.
Amen.
Oh yeah, that's the number one command, isn't it? Adam and Eve, he said, listen, all I wanted you to do is just obey me. They couldn't do it. And the way back into God's kingdom is to do the exact same thing. You must obey God. And you might ask the question, obey God in what? Obey God in this. If you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, guess what? Heaven will be your home.
Yes, sir.
And that's easier said than done, isn't it? It's easy to say, I accept Jesus. And I can say those words, I accept Jesus. I can say I'm a Christian. But are you living like a Christian? And see, that's what Jesus is looking at. So Jesus comes to offer hope. Jesus comes to offer a way back into the kingdom of God. And he says, guess what? I am the one that's going to bring you back to the kingdom of God. I only got 3 points. And that leads me to point number one. And here's point number one. It's on the screen. The door is narrow. The door is narrow. Remember, the message is you must come in at the door. The door is narrow. Let's look at verse 22 through 24 again. And he went through the cities and villages, teaching and journeying toward Jerusalem. Then here's a question. Watch this. While Jesus was preaching, somebody got the nerve to interrupt Jesus while he was preaching and ask this question. Verse 23. Then one said to him, Lord, are there few who are saved? In verse 24, and he said to them, strive to enter through the narrow gate, the narrow door, for many, I say to you, will seek to enter and will not be able to get in. Guess what? The door to the kingdom of God is narrow, right? While Jesus is preaching, somebody asked a question about salvation. Listen to their question, and they specifically said, how many people are going to be saved, Jesus? That's what they were saying. How many people are going to make it into the kingdom, Jesus? And what is heaven's capacity? What is heaven? What is the max of number of people that can make it into heaven? Notice Jesus never answered his question directly. Jesus just said this. He says, he turns around and says, don't worry about how many, worry about who makes it into the kingdom of heaven. And people like that today, they worry about how many people going to heaven. No, don't worry about how many. You should worry about who gonna make it into the kingdom of God. Jesus encourages us to make, watch this, he says strive. He encourages us to make every effort to enter through the narrow door. My question is, why is the door narrow? Narrow means it's tight. Narrow means it's small. Narrow means it's hard to get in. Reminds me of a scripture Jesus said. He says, broad is the street. Right? He talks about a street there. Broad is the street that leads to destruction. And he says, and many are on that road. But straight and narrow is the road that leads to life. And every now and then you'll find somebody on that road. Jesus answered the question. He just didn't directly tell them how many people was going into heaven. But he says, guess what? It's not that many, because Jesus said, if you can't get through the narrow door, you won't get in. That's what he's telling. He's just telling them. He just told them plainly. But we spend much time today talking about who is in the crowd and who the crowd consists of, instead of telling people that they need to get in through the narrow door. You know what that means this. You got all these religions out there. You got all these denominations out there, right? And every one of them, the religions, the denominations, all of them say, we are the way to get to heaven. That's what they say, right? We are the way. Our way is the only way. Jesus didn't say that. Jesus says you got to go through the narrow door. Right? And guess who the narrow door is? Jesus is that door. He is the narrow door. So watch this. We can eliminate a lot of denominations and a lot of religions just by that one act alone, by saying, do they promote that Jesus is the only way to heaven? And if they can't promote that, that is not the way to go. So you could just eliminate a whole lot of people up there, right there. So in other words, Jesus is saying this. There should be a focus on your personal responsibility to have a relationship with God. That's what the focus should be. Not to join my denomination. Not to join, it's amazing how we talk about denominationalism. When people talk about denominationalism, every time I think about denominationalism, I think about conventions, and I think about all of these titles, and I think about this and that. And then I think about these denominations, especially African-American denominations. These denominations, we're not doing anything for the community. So, just to give you a little few facts, the largest black denomination is the Baptist denomination, if you did not know that. We have more people in the black Baptist denomination than any other denomination out there that's African American. Then you have the Church of God of Christ, then you got the PAW, the Pentecostals of the World, that's a greater grace. Then you got the Holiness Church, they are smaller, but there's no other denomination that is large. You have the Methodists, you have the Lutherans, we all are part of those denominations as well. But the largest is the Baptist. Now, let me tell you something about the Baptist. The Baptist Church, this particular denomination that we are in, we don't have to connect to any organization. We are all individually separated. In other words, there's nobody over me to tell me how to run this church. All right. I don't have a bishop. I don't have, I have a pastor, but he doesn't rule this church. Right? I have somebody I can go to and pray to. Other denominations, Church of God of Christ, Holiness, Apostolic, they have bishops. That means that their bishops can go into those churches and tell that pastor what to do. They can actually remove him from that church. Every Baptist church is autonomous of itself. Now, so when we join an organization like the National Baptist Convention, each pastor decides to join that on their own. So my question is, if you want me to join the National Baptist Convention that has more people than the National Democratic Convention, more people in their convention than the Republican Party in their convention, when they have conventions, over 150,000 people show up every single time, every year. Now, with all those black folks together, wherever state they're going to meet in, you would think they would put our money together and we could create a Christian school. Isn't that right? We should have a Christian Baptist Academy somewhere, right? With the National Baptist Christian Baptist Academy. We should have a school here in the city of Detroit. We should have a hospital named the National Baptist Christian Hospital. The Catholics got a hospital. The Methodists got a hospital. All the money they ask from us to keep their organization going, and we don't have a school.
All right.
And we gotta send our kids to the public school, and you already know that story. What's happening in those schools? And we don't have that. So don't come to me with denominationalism. The only reason we got Baptist on our name is because when we first started, we didn't even have Baptist on our name. We just had Christian Life Church. But then we started getting a whole lot of riffraff. When I say riffraff, I mean people that come in to say, listen, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, we're going to do this, we're going to teach that. And I was wondering where all these doctrines coming from, because to me, when people don't see a particular title on your church name, they think it's a free for all. They think they can come to your church and do whatever they want to do, say whatever they want to say, and say, yeah, we're going to do this. And then I said, no, not here. We follow the Bible.
Right.
We follow the Word of God. So I threw that on the, I put the Baptist back in our name because I had to figure out, well, at least when I say Baptist, I'm not under a whole lot of bishops who are going to try to tell me how to run my church. We are only under the Word of God. That's what we're under, right? That's what we under. That's what we do. Now, you do have a Baptist circle that they call themselves the Full Gospel Baptist. They started up and they do have bishops and all that kind of stuff. We're not a part of that. We are not a part of any organized Baptist organization until they can show me that they can help us. And if they can't help us, then why are we helping them? So we can get together and do this ourselves, and we can get together and help the community ourselves, and we can get together and do what God wants us to do ourselves, because if you're going to take my money and not going to offer any help for our struggling church, then why are we coming to your home? Just to come to preach to each other? No, we're not going to do that. We're going to come together, and we're going to come together, put our resources together, and see what we can do for this community. And if you don't want to do that, then you got to keep on going.
Amen.
That's what we actually need to do. So guess what? We're not involved into denominationalism, and I've been asked to come to these organizations. I've been asked to come to these meetings, and I refuse to go because you're just having meetings. You're not doing anything. We're not doing anything. Look at our city. Look at the city of Detroit. We got a church on every corner.
Amen.
We got, where are the meetings leading to?
Yeah.
We were just talking about this in Sunday school this morning. We have one of the worst drug addiction epidemic in this country right now. What are we doing? And all of them don't stand in the street either. Some folks in church drug addicted, right? Because if one out of every 12 says one, every one person in every 12 minutes die of an overdose of drug. Every 12 minutes somebody died in this country of a drug addiction. All the folks are not unchurched people. There's some church folks that are addicted, right? There's some church folks that's going through some trials and tribulations. And if we're all talking about just going to another meeting and going to another revival, and I'm going to hear this singer, I got to go hear Tyler Cunningham, I got to go hear Yolanda Adams, they're not doing nothing for you. But you don't spend all that money to go to a concert instead of going and putting our money together to find some resources to help our community. I didn't mean to go that route. I'm sorry. I went totally left there. Let me get back to my message. Anyway, denominationalism, that's what made me go there. Denominationalism, Jesus said, listen, don't worry about that. You got to make sure your reservation is right with God. In order to get through the door, in order to get to heaven, do you have a reservation? Do you, and have you made your peace with God? Yeah. Do you walk up to Jesus and say, Jesus, I need a relationship with you? That's all you need. Because Jesus is that door. He is the narrow door. And if you have not made that relationship with him, how are you going to make it into the kingdom of God? Don't let any religion tell you they are right. You tell them, no, I don't know about if you're right or wrong. All I know is Jesus is right. And I know that Jesus said, in order for me to get to heaven, I got to go through him. Jesus didn't tell me I had to wear a special hat. He didn't tell me I had to wear special clothes. He didn't tell me to put my cross, wear my cross on the left, put it in my left pocket, then I'm going to be somebody. He didn't tell me to wear this color. He didn't tell me to have my hair cut a certain way. He didn't tell me that. He said, if I had a relationship with him, then I'm going to make it to the kingdom of God. But people are caught up into their traditions, they're caught up into their rituals, they're caught up into their clothes, and they think that's going to make them into, let them into the kingdom of God, and that's not going to let you in. You need Jesus in your life. You know, some people say that they just need to believe in something. No, you need Jesus to believe in. You know, somebody said that they remember what President Bush, that was the son of Bush, said on national TV. He said, there was many roads to heaven. It's not many roads to heaven. There's only one way to heaven, and that is Jesus Christ himself. All roads don't lead to heaven. So I don't care what the Buddhists say, what the Hindus say, what the Jehovah's Witnesses say, what the Muslims say, what the Mormons say. If they don't teach that Jesus is the narrow door that's going to get you into heaven, hell will be their home. That's something we need to really grasp on too. They all claim, all of them claim to have eternal life. All of them claim that they're going to live in a paradise, but they don't claim to live in a paradise with Jesus. They just believe Jesus was a good man. We tell you Jesus is God in the flesh, and that through him, he's the only one you can have a relationship with. Somebody need to say amen. So yes, you can't get to heaven just by your religion. It brings me down to point number two. Point number two is this. Watch this. Not only is the door narrow, but the door is closing. The door is closing, y'all. Look at verse 25 through 27. It says this. When once the master of the house has risen up and shut the door, and you begin to stand outside and knock at the door, saying, Lord, Lord, open for us. And he will answer and say to you, I do not know you. Where you are from, then you will begin to say, we ate and drank in your presence, and you taught in our streets. But he will say, I tell you, I don't know you. Where you are from, depart from me, all of you workers of iniquity. So yes, the door is open. Jesus is the door, but the door is closing. And once the door has closed, there is no more or no other way you can get into heaven. So if Jesus is the door, and he's that narrow door, when is the door going to close? I'm going to give you two answers. I'm going to give you the long answer, then I'm going to give you the short answer. There's two ways that the doors are going to close. Let's talk about the long way. The long way is the door is going to close not after the rapture, because people are going to be getting saved in the tribulation. So the door is not closed. The door is not going to close after the tribulation, because after the tribulation is the 1,000-year reign with Jesus. And there are going to be people living in that time, and they're going to need the message of Jesus Christ, and they have to accept him as their Savior. And that lasts for 1,000 years. So that door closes. When God says no more preaching of the gospel is when, at the end of the 1,000-year reign of Jesus Christ, when it's all over, Satan is let loose, tries to start a fight with Jesus all over again. He destroys him with just one word. That is it. The door is closed. Now, how many years is that from? If the rapture took place today, you're looking at over 1,000 years from now. That's the long version. So he said, I'll be dead be by that time. Yeah, you probably will be, but guess what? That brings me to my second point. The door closes when you die. Yeah, that's the long version. It's going to close one day for everybody, but it's going to close for you when you close your eyes and leave this planet. When you die and you have not met Jesus as your Savior, the door has closed on you. You see, you can't wait till you get to the other side. I want Jesus now, dog. It's too late. Because if you wait till you get to the other side and then you want Jesus on the other side, you are already in eternity. And you cannot turn around and in eternity say, okay, I'm going to bow now. No, it's too late. You should have bowed while you were alive on earth, right? You should have bowed when that door was open for you. So the door closes for every person that dies. So that's why we as Christians, we talked about this morning, we as Christians, we hurry, tell people, get saved now, get saved now. We tell people, get saved while you are alive. We tell people today, now is the time, an acceptable day of the Lord to receive Jesus, because once you leave here, you won't have that opportunity. The door will be closed for you. Somebody said, I'm glad I got Jesus right now. If you're glad you have Jesus, come on, put your hands together. I'm glad I got Jesus right now. You see, those people who let the door close on them, those people who let the door close and they died and left the door without accepting Jesus Christ, guess what? They lived their life. They lived their life the way they wanted to. They lived their life like that, like Adam and Eve I told you about, disobeying God. They lived the life saying, I can do what I want to do, say what I want to say, play how I want to play. Yeah, they did that, and they died without God. And they went on the other side, and they found out that the door was closed, and that hell will be their home. They enjoyed their life. They enjoyed ignoring God. They enjoyed ignoring the calling of God on their life. Because let me tell you something. God called them. Yes, he did. He told them every single time. They had chance after chance after chance to make it right on this side, but they refused. And guess what? When they let that door close, meaning they died without accepting Jesus, then hell will be their home. That's why Jesus called them, you evildoers, you workers of iniquity. I don't even know you. And the crowd said, wait a minute, Jesus, maybe we got this wrong, because we are the same ones. Remember they said this in one of the verses, we ate with you. That's what they said. We ate with you. We gathered. The crowds gathered at the door and said, we ate with you, Jesus. You taught us in the streets. Jesus says, I don't know you. I do not know you. In other words, you got to remember this phrase. I heard a professor a long time ago. I never, ever forgot what this professor said. I was at a convention. And he said this. He said, it's not about who you know. It's about who knows you. And I've never forgot about that. I said, what do you mean by that? It's not about who you know. Because people say, yeah, I know this person. I know that person. I can make things happen because I know. Well, listen, wait a minute. You got a lot of people say they know some celebrities. You got a lot of people that say they know Beyonce and Jay-Z, and they don't even know them from Adam. You got a lot of people that will perpetrate that they know somebody, but guess what? If they don't know you, you can't get nothing happening, right? You can't make nothing happen. It's not about who you know. So guess what? Some people know some facts about Jesus. They know he died on the cross. They know he was born of a virgin. They know those facts. They know he healed the sick. They know he raised the dead. But that don't mean you got a relationship with Jesus. And it doesn't mean that you have, that he knows you. So guess what? It got to be a two-way thing. You got to know the person and they got to know you. You got to have a relationship with them to get some things going. You can't just say you have a relationship with somebody and you really don't have a relationship with them. And then last but not least brings me down to my last point, point number three. Yeah, so the door is narrow, the door is closing. Guess what? The door also separates. Look at verse 28 through 30. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham. Watch this. When you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, and yourselves thrust out. You on the other side, and you looking over there, you see Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, but you not on that side, you on the outside looking in. Look at 29. They will come from the east and the west, from the north, from the south, and sit down in the kingdom of God. You gonna watch it. Yeah, those people that's on the other side, did you know people can look up from hell and see what's going on in heaven? They're going to see what they missed in heaven. And indeed, look at verse 30. And indeed, there, watch this, there are last who will be first, and there are first who will be last. People gonna look at that, what Johnny doing up there? He should be over here with me. That's what you thought. You thought Johnny should be on your side. You see, you didn't know. While you was letting the door close, while you were still out there letting the world influence you, Johnny, right before he died, gave his life to Jesus. So you see Johnny over there, you over here, and said, no, he should be over there. Guess what? Yes, the door is narrow. Yes, the door is closing. But the door separates. What does it separate? It separates heaven from hell. And we already know who the door is. Jesus is the door. He is the one that separates us from heaven and from hell. If you don't walk into the door, hell will be your home. And that's why, you know, we don't hear sermons like this that much anymore, do we? We hear sermons about money, right? We hear sermons like you get your nice clothes. You hear sermons how you can become wealthy. You hear sermons how you should get some exercise. Exercise your spirit and get Jesus in your life. Exercise our spiritual growth so we can grow in Christ and we can meet those people on the street and tell them, listen, I'm no better than you. You got to come to Jesus just like I came to Jesus. And guess what? If you come to Jesus, I'm not telling you your life won't be perfect, but at least you're on your way to heaven. I'm not going to tell you you're not going to mess up, but at least you got somebody to go to when you fall. I'm not going to tell you that every day going to be sunny. At least you got somebody who will never leave you nor forsake you when you're going through your trial and tribulation. Do I have some witness here that Jesus is not sending anybody to hell? You can remember that. Jesus is inviting people to go to heaven. That's all he's doing. He says, I am the narrow door. I invite you to come through me to get into heaven. I didn't send you to hell. You refused to walk through the door. And when the door closed, you have to go to hell. Sometimes I think I told you this over and over again. Your individual sins is not what's sending you to hell. Your drug addiction is not sending you to hell. I'll say some more about it. Don't get lost there. Your prostitution is not sending you to hell. Your homosexuality is not sending you to hell. Here's the thing is, what's sending people to hell is that they will let the addiction, the homosexuality, the prostitution, they will love that more than walking through that door. You mean to tell me how that all they had to do was walk through the door to get to heaven? Yeah, but see, before you walk, it's real narrow. Stand up real quick. The door is real narrow. He's the door. And he's standing right here at the door. This is the way to get in. Now, Jesus said, in order to get through the door, you got to get through him, right? But I can't get in. Jesus said, okay, wait a minute. You know, you got to drop off some things. What do I got to drop off? The homosexuality, the prostitution. Well, I just want to get in. No, you don't want to get in if you don't want to bring. See, there's some baggage you can't take to heaven with you. Sin is baggage, right? Your individual sins are baggage, and if you don't want to leave that here to walk into the door, you're not getting in. So people love their individual sin. So the individual sin is what's not stopping them. It's their love of those sins that's stopping them, which means they reject him. They reject his way. They reject his interest. And if you don't want to go in the way he said come in, you can't get in. Thank you. You can't get in. So don't let that be your rejection. Don't let nothing stop you from getting into the kingdom of God. The only people who will go to hell are the people who ignore Jesus Christ. The only people who are going to hell are people who refuse to listen to Jesus, to accept him as their savior, and say, Lord, whatever you want me to do. I was watching a preacher earlier this week, and he said somebody questioned him about homosexuality. He's the pastor of a large church, maybe 20,000 members. And he said, why is it that people love to bring that sin up when it comes down to talking about sin? He says, I'm against homosexuality just like I'm against adultery. Adultery just as bad as homosexuality. I'm against homosexuality just like I'm against stealing. Stealing is just as bad as homosexuality. So he says this. He said, listen, how about this? Let's just say it this way when it talks about getting into the kingdom of God. Let's say this. Whatever God says to get into his kingdom, that's what we got to do. He's God. So if he come up with a plan to get into his kingdom, who am I to argue with God on his way of how to get into the kingdom of God? Let's say it that way. So you ain't got to mention homosexuality. You ain't got to mention any sin. All you got to mention is you got to obey me. and get into the kingdom of heaven. And that means this: you got to live the lifestyle I want you to live. Now, if you don't want to do that, then you don't want to obey me. So if you don't, this is what Jesus is saying. So that's any sin. That's not just homosexuality. That's just not adultery. That's just not lying. That's just not, that's any sin. We can put any sin before God and love it so much that it causes us not to make it into the kingdom of God. You gotta have a relationship with Him. Was that going to my seat as I conclude this? This, yeah, nothing sends you to hell but our rejection of Jesus Christ. In the end, Jesus is going to say this to everybody: you must come in at the door. That's exactly what Jesus is going to say. You knew me, you knew about me, but you still got to come in at the door. You talked about me, but you still got to come in at the door. You spent time with me, but you never really got to know me. You must come in at the door. Your life wasn't about me. Your life was about you, but you still got to come in at the door. You weren't dedicated to me. You must come in at the door. You may know my name, but you are not wearing my name. You must come in at the door. If you knew Jesus, then you would turn to Him in times of need. If you knew Jesus, you would turn to Him even in the times of trouble. If you knew Jesus, you would stand up for Him at work and tell your friends they must come in at the door. Yes, and listen, you need to tell them that they must walk in through Jesus in order to get into the kingdom of God. You need to tell them the only way to enter in, that they got to come through the Lord Jesus Christ Himself. They got to lay down their lifestyle, pick up Jesus' lifestyle, and say, I must come in at the door. You got to choose to walk away from popularity. You got to choose to walk away from some family and some friends. You got to tell them they must come in at the door. Walking through the door of Jesus means that Jesus is the way. He is the truth, and He is the life. He is the only one that will turn you around. He is the only one that you should follow. You must come in at the door. He is the only one that you will worship every Sunday morning and every single day of your life. You must come in at the door. Jesus is the door that leads to life. He invites you to enter in. He invites you to come on in to have a good time with you. Listen, those last few verses said that there's going to be a party in heaven. Walk into the door. There's going to be a feast where all the believers will get together. They're going to come from the east, he said. They're going to come from the west. They're going to come from the north. They're going to come from the south. They're going to sit at Jesus' kingdom. They're going to sit at the table because they came in at the door. Your life is not in vain because you live for Jesus. Your life is not in vain because you gave your life over to the Lord. You may not have everything you want, but you got everything you need because you came in at the door. You made Jesus your Lord and your Savior. He died so you could have victory. He died over 2,018 years ago, you can have a right to the tree of life. You don't have to let this world, the sins in this world, the things of this world, drag you down, because Jesus' blood pulls you right on up and takes you right into the kingdom of God. Can I get a witness that Jesus will do it for you? Can I get a witness that He'll turn you around? Can you say yes? Can you say yes? He died to set you free. You must come in at the door. Guess what? He's not going to leave you without any power. After you come in, after you make Him your Savior, He's going to fill you with His power of the Holy Ghost. So I say, thank God for the Holy Ghost. Yeah, it's the Holy Ghost that will lead you. It's the Holy Ghost that will guide you. It's the Holy Ghost that will reveal the word to you because you came in at the door. Put your hands together. Tell the Lord, thank you. Tell the Lord, thank you. You came in at the door. I close. Thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for allowing us to come in at the door, to come in accepting Jesus as our Savior. And Lord, now we know if we don't do it, if we don't accept him, then heaven will not be our home. And Heavenly Father, it is our job and it is our desire to see others come to the door of Jesus, accept Jesus as their Savior, and begin to live for him, to let the world know that Jesus is the Savior of their life. Everybody, somebody here, while every head is bowed and every eye is closed, they want Jesus to be the head of their life. They want to be at that door. They want to walk through that door of salvation. They want to be all the way in with Jesus. That means they're willing to give up this world, give up their ways to accept Jesus as their Savior. If you're here today, while every head is bowed, I want you to pray this prayer with me. If you want to make Jesus your Savior, your Lord, repeat these words. Heavenly Father, I come to you as humble as I know how, acknowledging that I was born in sin and shaped into iniquity. I was born into the kingdom of Satan, but right now, in the name of Jesus, I renounce that kingdom. I accept your invitation to walk in through your Son, Jesus Christ, to walk through the door of Jesus for eternal life. Right now, I'm willing to give up my sinful lifestyle, to accept his ways, to accept his rules, to accept his way into his kingdom. Right now, in Jesus' name, I believe in my heart, Father, that you raised him from the dead. I believe in my heart, Father, that you sent your Son down the cross for my sin. And I confess right now that Jesus is the head of my life, and I turn my life over to him right now in Jesus' name. Amen. The doors of the church open. Everyone standing, please stand. If you pray that prayer, please make your way down here. Yes. The door is open for you today. As they say, make your way down.
Yes, Jesus is the only way. He's the truth and he's the life. In order to get into the kingdom of heaven, we have to go by Jesus. So we pray that this message has blessed you, it has encouraged you, it has given you a greater understanding of the relationship that you will have with Jesus when you accept him to be your Lord and Savior. If you prayed that prayer, please let us know. We want you to come and to visit Christian Life Baptist Church at 13050 Puritan at the corner of Ward inside of Detroit Center. You have a relationship with him. He wants to have a relationship with you. He wants to come and commune with you, but you first have to accept him. Please join us again next Sunday, again same time at 11:35 we go live, and you are welcome to come and visit us anytime. If this message has blessed you, go onto our Facebook page at christianlifec.org and hit the donate button. You can give a one-time donation or you can give it reoccurring. No money is too little, no amount is too great. All of it will go into spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. Be blessed.
Listen to the power of the Holy Spirit. Listen to the voice of God on the inside of you. Thank you, Lord.